No, we don't have to perform.
Thank goodness.
Thank goodness.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Tom Petway. I'm the chairman of the board of the Jacksonville Electric Authority, and I'd like to welcome everyone to our meeting today. Now I'd like to go on record and explain why we have such a small audience today. But I don't have anything to say. Carly, we've been having some very roomful meetings up until today, so we're happy to have you join us.
Thank you. I'm not drawing any conclusions.
No, don't. I wasn't going to go there. But welcome to you.
Thank you.
You have our agenda in front of you, and I'm going to call this meeting to order, the May 17th, 2016 meeting at 12:09. If you would stand, we'll have a moment of reflection and pledge to the flag, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I would like to have a motion and a second to adopt the agenda, please.
Second.
A motion and a second. Discussion? Being no discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you. We've approved the agenda. And we will have our safety briefing from our CEO, Paul McCoy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Every meeting at JEA, we start with safety briefing. Safety is a critical core value of JEA. In the event that we are called to exit the building due to an emergency, we will exit to the left of the elevators that we came up on. There's a stairwell there. We'll take that stairwell down. We'll walk in a controlled fashion, hold the handrail. When we exit, we will move to the southeast corner of Church in Main in the open parking lot and gather there. Ted Hobson will call 911 and security, and Patrick McGiss will make sure that we can get out of the room in an orderly fashion. We have restrooms over to the left, and I ask and encourage everybody to put their cell phone on silent or vibrate. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Paul. Everybody put their cell phone on silent, like me.
I did.
We need a Sunshine Law public record statement from our General Counsel Office Representative, our attorney, Jody Brooks.
Thank you, Chairman. This meeting is being conducted as a publicly noticed meeting in compliance with the Sunshine Law, so it's been duly noticed, and minutes will be taken.
Questions? All right, we'll move to item two, presentations and comments. We'll start with the Board of Directors Ethics Training. We have today Carla Miller, who is here representing the City of Jacksonville, and is the Ethics Officer since 1999, and the first director of the Independent Ethics Office. It's nice to have you with us. I'd like to read a few words here from your bio so we can have a little information about you before you start. And I think you know everybody, but we might go around the boardroom and introduce everybody. I'll introduce everybody to you as well. My eye takes me to the next paragraph, it starts, she is a gator and a Seminole. I got another paragraph I got to read first, and I'll come back. I'm going to come back to that, okay? Just think about that. She has spent over 20 years building the city's ethics program, including writing our local ethics laws and chairing the Ethics Commission. Last year, she drafted the law putting a referendum on the ballot for our city, which created a new Inspector General's office. She is a gator and a Seminole. And she has received her BA degree in criminology from FSU and her law degree from the University of Florida. There you go. After law school, Carla was a federal prosecutor in Jacksonville and was responsible for political corruption cases. Carla also founded City Ethics, a nonprofit organization that provides information to local governments across the world on starting and improving ethics programs. Last year, Carla finished her two-year fellowship at the Ethics Center at Harvard. Nice to have you with us, and we're looking forward to your presentation. Let me just quickly go around up here. You probably know most of us, or have met most of us, but Ed Burr is the vice chairman of the board. Alan Howard is our lawyer representative on the board.
Chair of Government Affairs.
Yeah, and chair of Government Affairs, excuse me. And we have Dolores Kessler, and you know Jody Brooks, and Warren Jones, and Hussein Comer, and Kelly Flanagan. And you know Paul, and you know me. So please proceed.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting the city of Jacksonville to come over to supplement the training that you already have from Jody and from Willetta, because you have a very strong ethics program with JEA. Doris Champ, when she was in your auditor's office, did a brilliant job in doing ethics risk assessments. I was talking with Paul about that. And actually, when we met with all of the independent authorities, JEA would always sit at the head of the table with Doris and Willetta, and they would talk about, well, here's what JEA is doing. And it was always tracking best practices of corporate America. You know, so well done, and thank you for having me over to supplement what you already have going on. Now, I'd also like to introduce Kirby Oberdorfer, and she's my deputy director. Kirby is a former law professor, and she's available also to answer any questions, to do legal research, and I'm very pleased to have her in the office. So here's the first question I want to ask you, and since this is ethics, I want you to tell the truth, even though you're being filmed. And this is when you knew when you knew that we were going to have an hour of ethics training from an attorney. How excited were you to be here today on a scale of 1 to 5? 5 being you called Paul and said, I can't believe it. Why aren't we having Carla all day? Because we really need all day. That's a 5. You're really eager to be here. 1 is you're thinking, okay, if I just text while I'm at the meeting here, I can do other business, and I know this stuff already. That's like a 1. You really don't want to be here. So I want you to tell me the truth. I want you to get a number in your head. How much you want to be here on a scale of 1? Yes, we already have 10. A 1 in evidence right now. Okay, scale of 1 to 5, and get your number. Okay, do we have any 5s? All right, an honest group.
Can I text you my answer?
No, don't text me anything in this meeting. A 4.
Please don't text me.
Please don't text anything. A 4. Do we have 4s? A 3? 3? Okay, 2s.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you, Warren.
Warren.
Teacher's pet. And
Warren,
Alan was, okay.
Camera's rolling, Warren.
Alan, 2. Now.
I'll give you a 2.
Okay, 2s?
Solid 2.
1s? One, all right. Thank you. I appreciate your honesty. I got a call a couple of weeks ago from another board member, not from JEA, another board member, and he said, I just got appointed by the mayor, and I need heads up, some information on ethics. And so I thought it'd be like a 5-10 minute phone call. We were on the phone for an hour. Then he called me back. Then he called me the next day, and we've had this ongoing conversation about ethical issues. And that's my first preference, if I could sit down with each of you and really kind of talk about like what your thoughts are and what issues you think that you might run up against. That would be better, but we don't have time to do that. So this is a bit formal, and it's not my first preference for really getting to know you and dealing with the ethics issues, but you can always call me later on. Of course, you always have access to Jody and Willetta, Kirby. You know, you've got a lot of people supporting you. Even though it's a little bit formal, I want you to ask questions. It seems like the group isn't shy and that you'll ask questions. So there's many ways to skin this cat and give you ethics training. Here's the worst way. A lawyer standing up in front of you, putting up PowerPoint screens with a whole bunch of the law and reading it to you, that makes people very unhappy. You know, so I've learned not to do that. And so knowing the expertise of this group, and that a lot of you are very experienced in boards in the city, how to hit the right note, not to make it too simple, not to make it too complicated, how to make it interesting. Kirby and I don't sing and dance, but I'm trying to bring you the things that I thought would be most useful to your board. So first of all, there's two ways we can go with this, the big picture, the little picture, and the rules. Now, I don't know, everybody is sort of, they put themselves in a category, whether they're a big picture person, or they just, would you tell me what the rules are? Because I just want to know the rules, tattoo them on my hand, don't tell me why. I tend to be in the big picture area, and I like to know sort of some of the reasoning. So I'm going to cover both of those. For those of you that like, just tell me the rules. If you could suffer through some of the big picture stuff, then we'll go into some specific things that you need to know. And of course, I'm going to ask Warren for his help on all this, because he's been through about 10 ethics trainings, so he's heard many of this before. So first of all, I'm going to tell you five big picture things that I've accumulated over probably 40 years of working in the criminal justice system in Jacksonville and just finishing my two-year fellowship at Harvard at the Ethics Center. What ideas of the hundreds I've stuffed in my head would I think would be most interesting and appropriate for you? And I picked five. I picked five for you. So the first one doesn't seem like it would fit in ethics training, but it really does. And it's all of the research on authenticity. And there's a wonderful report from Francesca Gino at Harvard, and I'll send you the report if you're interested in this, but drilling down on it, it's not what you're doing that's important, but who you are and why you're doing it. Truly, it sounds obvious, but it's so key. And like, for instance, at JEA or any company, when someone starts a job, and everybody in here, and even in the audience, has started a job, you sit there and you get indoctrinated. These are the 100 things you need to know about JEA, about the company, and you stream that into people. But no one asks people why you want to be there, what you think is important, what you can contribute, and really drawing that out from people. And the research is really very interesting on this. So if you allow people to talk about who they are and why they're doing what they're doing, they're 6 times more likely to be engaged in their job and 3 times more likely to say they have an excellent quality of life. So I bring that up because I want to give you an example. And this example is, you heard a little bit from your chair about my CV, being a prosecutor and chair of the Ethics Commission and ethics director. Okay, those are all like the what. You know, everybody at this table has a long list of things on a CV, really stellar things. We can list, fill the table with lists of things that we've done. But what's the important thing? I mean, all of us could not be sitting here. We could be out playing golf. We could be on a cruise ship. Why are we here? Why are we spending this amount of time? I could be retired. My husband's Australian. We have a house in Australia. I am so dedicated to working in this particular program. I can't imagine when I would retire, and I think a lot of you are in that category. You are, you know, you could, but you're here at JEA. Why are you doing that? So I want to tell you a little bit about why I'm doing this as a foundation for what I'm going to be telling you. This is a picture of me in 1970, and I bring this up because I was at Florida State at the time, and I was going to Kappa Alpha Old South Weekend, and you had to dress in antebellum costumes. And at that time in 1970, I was on the fashion board at Ivy's, representing FSU. And this was the building. That's why I'm bringing it up. This was the building for Ivy's. And I got to stand up. I think we actually did it in this room. We put on evening gowns and bridal outfits, and we walked through the store. And, you know, it was an interesting time period, because my parents pretty much had me indoctrinated that what they wanted me to do, why they were sending me to FSU, to marry a lawyer or a doctor, to buy a house, have children, and have lots of money. This is my goal. You know, so I'm dressing in these evening gowns and walking up and down, hoping a lawyer would happen to be walking by that I could meet. Anyhow, my goals were, I wanted to become a lawyer, not marry a lawyer. I wanted to become a lawyer, and I wanted to change the world, and I was very idealistic. This picture of me going into the idealistic stage, which my father was horrified. He had just moved over here post consolidation of the city to start up the junior college, Florida Junior College, Dr. Carl Miller. And so he moved the family over here right at consolidation, right after it. And so this corresponds to some Jacksonville history that we tend to forget. And you know the saying about if you forget about history, you tend to repeat it. So what we have is in the 1960s, right before I moved over here, we had a grand jury, the word that Warren mentioned in which time. Senator Bill Beaufort tells Southside Businessmen's Club that public officials get low pay and taking 5 to 10% off the top is traditional in Jacksonville. And we have 11 public officials indicted on 142 counts of bribery and larceny, 4 of the 9 city council, 2 of 5 city commissioners, city auditor, head of city recreation department, purchasing agents, city tax assessor took the 5th. All of that led to our consolidation in 1968. So right around that time when I decided, okay, I'll try to marry a lawyer, but I want to be a lawyer too. When I came out of law school, I was appointed federal prosecutor for this area. And this is my little group. Some of them are judges, Judge Howard Snyder in the front and Judge Tom Morris in the back, and really great group of federal prosecutors. But when I hit that office, they said, we have an FBI informant that's at a restaurant on Phillips Highway, and we have a video camera back there. And we're videotaping all of these public officials coming into the back room. And there were about 50 different investigations from the U.S. Attorney's Office going into all aspects of City Hall. And we used to talk about, well, we're having grand jury tomorrow. Do we need a bus to go over to City Hall to pick up the people? Because we had so many people. My prosecution that I focused on was Senator Dan Scarborough, Harold Haimowitz, former Mayor Lou Ritter. And that was my second case in the U.S. Attorney's Office. I felt like saying, could you start me with some drunk driving cases at the Navy base? You know, I mean, really. But it was fascinating. It was a one-year grand jury leading to indictments. A few years ago, I saw this obituary for Dan Scarborough, and it made me sad. You know, it was like former Senator Scarborough, one of Florida's most powerful senators until his political career ended with his 1982 conviction of mail fraud and extortion, died. And, you know, I thought about that, and I thought about the people. When you're in a 2-month federal trial, you know, you sit at this table, all the defendants sit over at the other table, you go to the same place to drink coffee, you get to know them after 2 months, they seem like nice people. And I thought, how'd they get involved in this? You know, they're all going to federal prison. One of them called me from federal prison, and he was crying. You know, and I went, hush, you know, I mean, what do you do about this? So we go on from 1985, just a few years from there, general counsel of our city was indicted and convicted. More indictments for the mayor's chief of staff, motor pool director, public safety director, tax assessor, it goes on. We get into the reform period, which is, you know, really an exciting time in the history of our city. There was a grand jury led by young prosecutor John Delaney, and he came up with recommendations that there should be an ethics commission in the city. And so that led to a task force on the ethics code that he started up, and so I called him up and I said, I've got some ideas because I was a federal prosecutor, I'd like to help you. And he said, well, if you do a really good job on this board, maybe one day you can get appointed to one of the big boards, the important boards, you know, like JEA or JTA. I said, well, I don't know. I really like the ethics area. But anyhow, so that was in 1999. We had the first ethics code for the city, leading to the first ethics training in 1999. We were the first city in Florida to require ethics training of all of our officials, because I thought, how unfair to have all you guys come in here, and you're all subject to state ethics laws, but nobody's trained you on it. What are you supposed to be born with this knowledge? So we were very fortunate to have this training. So I guess just to finish, you know, I think about why I have done this for 45 years in Jacksonville. And I look at picture of someone I convicted and other people I convicted. And I think at the time I was in a state of shock right out of law school. You know, you're saying, oh my gosh, I can't believe that corrupt person is taking a bag of money out of a restaurant to bribe someone, and we've got them on tape. I can't believe these people are doing it. Well, after 45 years, I would say my feeling is more of compassion, and I understand there's a study, seems pretty obvious, that you've got, like, if you take all people in this room, in this planet, you've got a few people over here who are just basically evil, And no matter where you put them, they're going to do bad things. Then you've got really, really good people at the other end. You know, they're just saints. I put Charlie Bennett, our former congressman, in that category because he was wonderful. You know, we've got saints, probably some in this room. But the vast majority of us are in this middle group that, given the right temptation, lack of controls, confusion, you know, a combination of it, we can all start taking steps towards being on the front page of the paper and having the FBI come with a subpoena. I mean, none of us, you know, none of us are perfect, you know. So I keep thinking some people get caught up in that and their whole life is ruined. And so it's always been my cause to try to figure out why that happens and what kind of safeguards or what kind of training can we put into place to save talent. He was a star football player, University of Florida. He was, he had all the markings of a whole lifetime of public service that went into a tailspin. How do we save people like that? And how do we make sure that none of us drift, because we're all human? So anyhow, that's why I do what I do. Now, going into the big picture, I want to mention the concept of what's your purpose about learning about government ethics, because right now you are in a mini seminar learning about government ethics. Why would you do that? Why would you do that? Just because you have to check a box that you've done it? I mean, to say that you did it, or because it's mandatory? Is that the purpose for government ethics? I'd like to just share with you a quote from Dennis Thompson, who's considered to be probably the world authority on government ethics. He wrote a book called Ethics in Congress, an interesting title, and I met him up at Harvard, and I thought that the way he encapsulated the purpose of government ethics really felt true to me. And he said, the purpose of government ethics is to educate officials about your important role in American democracy. If you personally benefit from holding a public position, it leads to unfairness and a breakdown of our democracy. And that's the real reason we have all of the ethics rules that we have, because it's essential to our form of government. And in fact, different lecture, different concept, but our whole country was formed on ethics and anti-corruption. I thought the beginning of it was Watergate. Didn't go back far enough. It's really 1776 and the Declaration of Independence, because we declared to King George, you are corrupt, and we are tired of having your people come over here, your cronies and your people take our land, and we're going to fight to the death for this. And in the actual congressional Congress, where they were coming up with our Constitution, at least 60% of the conversations were on ethics and anti-corruption, gifts, and how do we keep people from being corrupted. So it really runs through the whole core of our government. So Dr. Bill English says, our institutions are in crisis. Wonderful paper he wrote on this. Institutions are increasingly corrupted, and our form of government is fragile. There's a threat of demise of our form of government, and that's why it's so important to hold the line on ethics and anti-corruption. And I think, this is my personal opinion, that at the congressional level, at the national level, a lot of those battles have been lost. But our real hope is at the local level, to hold the line and to really be stellar at the local level, at every board, at every department of the city, because we can build that from the bottom up. Trust in federal government is going down. We get the backlash of that. Our trust in federal government now is lower than it was during the Revolutionary War. More people trusted King George than we now trust our Congress. So this is something that you get the backlash of. Oh, your government, you know, you must be corrupt. You're getting the backlash of this bad trust in national government. So next concept I want to run over is, this is research. It's one concept I wanted to get across to you. I actually presented this at Harvard to the Ethics Center. This is my theory, the three-dog theory of ethics. All ethics programs are going to fall into one of these categories. And I want to tell you the categories because they're so important and you need to identify ethics programs. The first is the lapdog program. This is a program where it's really cute. It's in existence, and everyone pets it, but really, it doesn't do anything. It's cute, though. You've got one. You've got one. And, of course, the best example of this is my collector's item here. This is what I got from my husband for Christmas. Some people get jewelry. This is a collector's item from eBay. This is an ethics code on respect, integrity, communication. You know where it's from.
I can see the symbol at the bottom right. It's Enron.
Yeah. So this is Enron's ethics code. They had $1 million ethics program. You know, it's just that it was kind of over here. And everybody, the culture was over here doing their own thing, you know, and the two did not meet. And so that's my example of a lapdog program. Then we've got the attack dog. And usually when you talk to elected officials, they say, oh my gosh, you know, the ethics commission, you know, ethics, they're going to come and they're going to find something wrong here and it's not going to be fair. You know, it's the gotcha mentality. You know, and you've heard that term. It's like, oh, there's so many rules and I mean well, and they just went into a gotcha on me. That's the attack dog type of ethics program. And then you have the watchdog. And the watchdog program is where we are trying to actually implement the checks and the balances and all of the structures that will help people just go on and do their job and not have to worry about all of the ethics rules. That's the watchdog, and that's the type of program that we're trying to do for Jacksonville. Next big picture item. All I needed to learn about ethics I learned in kindergarten. So I hear this a lot. It's like, why am I sitting here? I am a good person. I go to church. I am a good family member. You know, my heart's good, really. I learned this at an early age, and you can't teach people when they get older. They're either good or bad. Well, this is really a very big problem that we just have to talk about. That is, I already know this stuff. I have good instincts because I'm a good person. Let us assume that everyone here in this room is a good person. But there is a difference between personal ethics and government ethics and organizational ethics. I didn't get this for a long time. You know, it's like, do we teach people to be honest and, you know, respectful? No, they better have learned that by the time they come into a city job. We're not teaching personal ethics. Organizational ethics are a different beast. And so we have personal ethics like, are you respectful? Are you kind to older people? Are you hardworking? You know, all the things that we want in our employees. We don't want them to be unethical. But these are things that really the character is kind of set earlier on. But take a look at organizational ethics. No conflicts, independent judgment, transparency, sunshine. If your parents were teaching you about the sunshine law when you were in kindergarten, they were very strange. You know, so you did not learn these concepts. They are not intuitive. No personal gain. Interesting, because a lot of things you make personal gain, and it's also good for the city. It's also good for JEA, but you could be making a personal benefit from it too. It's like, wow, you're killing two birds with one stone. What could be wrong with that? Not intuitive. So private virtue and ethics is not necessarily public virtue. They're different creatures, just to remember that. And so you can be ethical on your personal level by giving gifts or getting a job for a friend, but it could violate government ethics standards. So your instincts, this is the problem. This is why people feel like there's a gotcha, because your instincts can lead you in the wrong direction, which is scary. So it's counterintuitive, and it can be complicated. But just because you're a good person doesn't mean you can figure out government ethics. That's why we have to have the training. So the last big picture thing is we would all like to think that we're like Mr. Spock from Star Trek. We listen to ethics training, and we get it. We know the rules, we understand it, and we will be analytical forever making these decisions. But the research is pretty strong that we're more, and it's proven out in many different studies, we're more like Homer Simpson, that when push comes to shove, we make a lot of decisions that probably if we were sitting and thinking about it for an hour like Mr. Spock, we would not do it that way. In the heat of the moment, under a lot of business pressure and stuff like that, we do stupid Homer Simpson type stuff, and a lot of research on that. So we don't always act the way we want to or the way we've been trained to, and that's the whole new area of behavioral ethics. Fascinating research in this, and I'll just give you a book if you want to read about it. But if they talk about stages of an ethical decision before you make it, like right now, we're talking about, would you violate the Sunshine Law? "Oh, no, never. You know, we get it." At the time something is happening and everybody's sort of going in a certain direction, really, you know, like you're going to be thinking 100%, sometimes it slips, you know, because you're at the point where a lot is happening and you have to make that logical decision. And then after the decision, of course, we all rationalize why it was the right thing to do. So one study that I think is really interesting is the job interview study, where they asked all these women, these women needed work. So they asked them, if you went to a job interview and a man about 30 was asking you the interview questions, and he asked your bra size, would you answer that question? And the women went, "No, no, that's awful. It's inconceivable that anybody would ask me that. What about prior sexual partners? Oh my gosh, you know, I'd just sue. Well, then of course they put them in a situation where they're interviewing for a job with a 30-year-old man who asked these questions. And what do you think? Sadly, the research showed they answered the questions. Now, a couple of them said, "You know, I don't mind answering your questions, really. I think you might want to check with your lawyer. Someone else might want to raise an issue." I, of course, don't want to raise an issue. This is one of many studies showing that what we intend to do, in the future, is not always, if it's in our self-interest, what we end up doing. The other study that I think is fascinating is one on picking art. Like if you were in a study group, imagine you go in and you're asked to pick your favorite piece of art. And so they rank it. And then they have another group come in and they say, okay, Walmart has paid for this study, and Walmart will give you each $100 to be here today to participate in this study. Pick your favorite art. And in one or two pieces of art, there's a small little Walmart logo. And which pieces of art, of course, get picked first? Always the ones with the Walmart logo that's very subtly in there. And there's a lot of studies along those lines when people say, well, you know, he took me out for dinner. Can't buy my vote or my influence for a dinner. Really? Maybe not logically. But there's a lot of research showing that we're influenced by this subconsciously. Truly, the research is pretty strong on that. So this is a colleague of mine from Harvard, and Max Bowserman wrote a book called Blind Spots. And he basically, I was talking to him, he said, ethics education doesn't work. And I said, that's not good news, Max, because I do a lot of it down in Jacksonville. What do you mean it doesn't work? He said, yeah, you talk to people, you tell them all this, and then they just go out and do something different. And I disagreed with him because I think ethics education does work. Although, how exactly to impinge enough that it becomes part of the culture is a real tricky thing, because I've been at trainings, I won't mention any particular groups, but I've been at trainings where we'll be talking about the Sunshine Law, and then they'll break to go for a lunch. And they're talking about all the issues that they were just discussing in their notice meeting. And they said, well, we kind of noticed the day. And I'm thinking, no, noticing the day does not get it. You know, if you're sitting in tables of eight, you know, how is a citizen going to hear what this table is saying and this table and this table? You know, it's just, so, I mean, I think ethics education does work. I'm eternally optimistic. I believe in people, and I believe that people can get the message and change the culture. Truly, or I wouldn't be doing this. I'd give up, like Max probably has. So here's my summer reading list for you. These are the ways, the solutions to get around our behavioral blind spots that we all have. First of all, you have to notice them. Like you have to be alert enough and not be caught up in the moment and the excitement that you can actually take a look at one of your board members and say, wait a minute, this doesn't seem quite right. You have to notice it, first of all. And blind spots prevent you from doing that. So the book Blind Spots is brilliant, and I highly recommend it. Speak up. It's another thing. How many times have we noticed stuff and it's kind of not politically correct to say anything? You know, you just kind of go with the flow. Who wants to be, you know, the goody two-shoes of the group going around saying, excuse me, didn't Carla bring this up at the ethics train? No, you don't want to say that kind of stuff. Or everyone's going out to dinner with a lobbyist. Who wants to say, well, I'm sorry, Do you think this will be over $100? Because I don't really think we should go. Don't you remember our ethics training? No. You know, you kind of don't want to do that, but there's speaking up. How do you do it tactfully enough and not ostracize yourself from the group? And giving voice to values is the book on that. It's being used in hundreds of corporations around America. Mary Gentile on actual techniques to train people how to tactfully bring things up that they see that are not optimum. And then create structures to avoid the conflicts so that people don't even have to think about it. And that's the famous book, Nudge, by Cass Sunstein. Another good recommendation for your summer reading list. Now, for the specifics, those were the big picture concepts I wanted to share with you. Now, because I'm a lawyer, I can't help it, I have to share with you the specifics. Now, before we get into it, this is how to stay out of trouble, how to stay out of the front page of the paper. Mainly to ask questions before you act. So these are going to be your danger areas, and Kirby's passing out your top 10 danger areas. I love this quote from Steve Jobs. He says, simple can be harder than complex. You have to work hard to get your thinking clean to make it simple. But it's worth it in the end, because once you get there, you can move mountains. So here's what we've got with Florida law on ethics. Now, I do not want to teach you how to be lawyers. I don't want to teach you the intricacies of Chapter 112. First of all, you'd hate me for going over all of this. Second of all, you wouldn't get it anyhow. Third, even attorneys, like I've been in general counsel's office, there's been three of us arguing about, well, this person came forward and they said they had a conflict. Do you think there's a conflict? Yes, I do, definitely. Well, I don't think there's a conflict. Well, why don't we call the State Ethics Commission? We call the State Ethics Commission. Is there a conflict? Well, maybe, maybe not. You know, you're thinking, could someone give me a straight answer on this? And you guys can be on the front page of the paper for this. And we're trying to figure it out with lawyers. So I can't teach you to be lawyers. But what I can do is I can give you the 10 danger areas in the last 40 years of everything that I've seen that will be the area that you can run into trouble with. And so at least if you can identify the area and you know some of the basic things in that area, you can identify and then you know to open mouth, ask questions. And that's about the best way, because I don't think you want to spend 2 days. Our first training in 1999, by the way, was 2 days of training trying to teach all of our elected officials how to be lawyers. It was painful. They looked sad. You know, so.
Born there.
He's always enjoyed the ethics training. I mean, we've gotten more simplified in trying to get you to identify issues, not be the lawyer. So, first of all, you might be in trouble if you take anything of value over 100 from someone for you or your family. This is the gift law, $100. Someone gives you something for $5, you have to worry about it. Unless there's a deal that you will vote a certain way, even for $5, you can't do that because that's a bribe. I love these quotes. Plato on gifts, public servants who receive gifts dishonor their position and should die. I mean, that's Plato's position. You receive a gift as a public official, it's the death penalty. And in fact, in China, there is the death penalty for some forms of corruption and for taking gifts. I think that's a bit severe, but a lot severe. And then in the Revolutionary War, there was a zero tolerance on gifts, a ban on the European culture of gift giving. They made Benjamin Franklin take back this really nice jeweled snuff box that the King of France had given to him. He didn't want to give it up. There's allegations that he removed some of the stones before he sent it back to the King of France. But anyhow, so this thing on gifts has been around a long time. Now, I know you've already had training on gifts, but I just want to emphasize the key points here. Everything is a gift. Anything anyone gives you, any nice thing that happens, everything is a gift. Even if it's good for the city or for JEA, it's a darn good idea, it's still a gift. So gifts can come into the city. Like JEA, like Paul could be sent 20 tickets to an event here in the city, and he can distribute them to people. Well, that's a gift to the JEA. That came into the JEA, and then when you get it, it's not a gift from the original party, it's a gift from JEA. You know, so you can accept that even if the value is over 100. So that's different. If someone comes up to you personally and they look you in the eye and say, I would like to give you 2 tickets to this special community dinner, and they're giving them to you directly, that's alert, warning, warning, what's the value? And I remember, got a gift question with John Delaney. You know, President Bush was coming through town, and said, hey, you want to go down to Clearwater on Air Force One? Yes. I mean, who would say no to that? It's a gift, a gift. Now, it's allowable, because certainly you can ride an Air Force One with the President of the United States, but it was a gift that had to be valued and put on his gift return. You wouldn't think that. That does not make sense, but that is the law. So gifts over 100 or 250 a year from lobbyists, principals, or employer, whoever employs the lobbyist, anyone wanting to do business with the city or JEA, any of this stuff coming in. So be alert. If someone's being nice and giving you something, the polite thing that we're trained to do as children, thank you very much for giving me this nice gift. Aren't you nice? No, you have to be rude. You have to say, excuse me, what's the value of this gift? I mean, who's trained to do that? But anyhow, you have to have your assistants get the value of things. Now, here's an exception that applies to all of you. A gift does not include under Florida law if you've got normal lives outside of JEA. You've got companies, corporations, businesses, your employees. Anything that comes to you from that, a salary, fees, commissions, gifts, someone brings you, I don't know, a bottle of liquor at Christmas time because they've always done it in your job, that is not a gift under Florida law. But it's primarily associated with your employment. So that means for the last 10 years, you've been getting the same gift from this business because of your business connection. That would not be a gift. But if you see something like that and it's valuable and that person also has to be lobbying this JEA or the city for something, it may be time to return the gift. Even if maybe technically you can receive it under this exception, there's always, even if you're following the law, the appearance aspect of it. Look, I've always taken this gift from you every Christmas for the last 10 years. I know it's only connected to my job here. But now that I'm on the JEA board, I'm really not accepting anything. So, hope you understand. You can't even take a cup of coffee if it's with the understanding that you'll vote a certain way, obviously. Now, if you make a mistake, and people can make a mistake, you've got 90 days to pay back the gift, pay it down. And that's happened in the city a lot. Didn't know the golf round was worth over $100. It was $150. You pay the $50 and you're under the law. Okay, number two, you might be in trouble if you ask for anything. Anything of value from someone for you, your family, your business associates, your friends. So you're walking out of this meeting and there's an attorney in the room. Someone in your family's just been arrested for drunk driving. It's ruining your family life. You go up to them and say, listen, so-and-so, my cousin or my niece is arrested for DUI. Do you know the judge that is hearing this case? I mean, what would you do? You're asking them advice, their professional advice. Doesn't that seem like what you'd ordinarily do with friends? If you know someone, you would ask them for help. You'd ask them for advice. I mean, I intuitively would do that. You can't do that now. You're soliciting. You're asking for something of value. Could you trim my bangs? Could you cut my hair? I know you do. No. No one does you any favors. You don't ask for any favors. And that goes that's a little counterintuitive, but just keep that in mind. But I was doing a good thing. Doesn't matter if the end result was good, you've still broken the law. So you can't use official letterhead for private projects. You don't ask a vendor or lobbyist for even $5 for a cake for a starving person. I mean, it doesn't matter how good the purpose is. You can't ask anyone for anything. If it benefits you or a family member in any way. Oh, my wife or husband is just having this big fundraiser. Listen, some people down Palm Beach County went to jail for this. We need to save the turtles. You need to save the turtles. So you ask all the lobbyists to contribute to this turtle fund when you're voting on, their zoning projects. Yeah, the turtles, we want to save turtles. We all do. But you can't ask anybody to help you. Number three, you might be in trouble if you go places out of town. When you step outside of Duval County, it should be in your own private car, private jet, private plane, bicycle. It should be on your own dime, on your money. If anyone else is paying for it, alert. Who's paying for you to go anywhere, and drill down on that. So moving outside of Duval County, I remember one time John Delaney was on the front page of the paper. I tried to find it. It's disappeared. I didn't clip it. It was like a long time ago. But he went down to Disney World and had all the mayors of Florida at Disney World. And they got to ride on these floats with their families. And he got free admission to Disney World. And there's a big story about how he went down. He went there, and some of the expenses were paid and some of the Disney stuff, but they just wanted to get all the mayors together. Seemed like a good idea, and he didn't break any laws. But it was just this whole thing of, well, you were down there, and Disney was giving your kids stuff. And then Jeb Bush, when he was governor, the Super Bowl was in Miami. Wouldn't you think the governor would go to the Super Bowl if it was in Miami? Well, he did, and a very wealthy friend of his gave him two tickets. They were worth $800. It's like, oh no. Front page of the paper again. They were legal. His friend didn't have anything to do with state of Florida business. Nothing. No, it was not an illegal gift. But the fact that he got two $400 tickets to the Super Bowl, I'm thinking, really? We need the governor to go to the Super Bowl. The state of Florida should have paid for it. What are you thinking? So we can get into these things when even when we're complying with the law, the appearance of it can be a front page story. That's where the gotcha mentality has emanated from. So I just mentioned it, you already know that, but if you go out of town, do not step on private jets. There's ways to do that, and you just need to ask ahead of time. A lot of it is fine if it's done correctly at the front end. Okay, so if the board sends you somewhere and JEA has you fill out an expense report and everything is paid by JEA, that's fine. That's a business expense coming from JEA. If anyone else wants to pay for you to go somewhere, check with Jody, check with Valletto, check with me. We'll sort it out for you on the legality of it. You're asked to be on a panel. You'll discuss a Jacksonville program. Someone other than JEA wants to pay for you to go. Okay, but get an okay in writing. If you want to protect yourself, I'm always happy to write something up for people. Ethics officer has reviewed this and it's okay. If for some reason, you know, it turns out to be wrong, I take the heat, not you. You know, and I'm happy to put that in writing. But do things to protect yourself so it doesn't come back on you. You might be in trouble if you fail to file financial or gift disclosure forms on time. You know about this, your financial disclosure and your gift disclosures. And this is basically financial when you come on the board, when you leave the board, and every July 1st in between. That's easy. And once you file your Form 1, it's pretty much the same every year. You know, that's an easy one to do. You'll get notifications on that. Gifts are quarterly. If you receive anything over $100 that's allowable. Now, you don't say, I received 10 tickets personally from the Jaguars. They just gave me 10 tickets, unless, of course, you're associated with them, and then you can take them as part of your business. But if you receive something over $100 from a prohibited party, you've broken the law, so you obviously don't declare that. You pay it down. You come to the ethics office to help you with that. You might be in trouble, number 5, if there's a conflict between your board duties and your personal life. This is the biggest area of State Ethics Commission complaints, conflicts. For example, you, anyone in your family, or your business partners try to do business with the board. You get anybody saying, hey, I know you're on the JEA board. Can you help me with such and such? No, I can't. So this is conflicts. And if you take a look at it conceptually, you've got like your JEA position, your family and friends, and your business associates. And when they intersect, when you say, I know that person, you're looking out in the audience, and you know the person that's coming in front of JEA, that's when you need to be alert. Is there a conflict? Are you going to be voting or doing something that puts you in a precarious position? This is why a board member from JPA went to prison. You know, so the conflict situations are something you have to be aware of, and it's just that intersection. Now, I will say that you will have conflicts because, you know, the book about 6 degrees of separation, in Jacksonville it's 2 degrees of separation. We all know each other. You know, we all have like, I'm one, two people, and you all are too. Maybe there's 1 degree of separation with some of you. That means that the chance of you having a conflict is very high. So when that happens, do not panic. Oh my God, I have a conflict. You know, something horrible is going to happen. No. Immediately go and speak to Jody. Give me a call. We'll let her, you know, like, just say, I think there's a conflict. And then we'll work it out for you. But the important thing is how you deal with the conflicts. You will have the conflicts. You would be, listen, if you're important enough to get on this board, you know a lot of people, and you will have people come to you. You're connected. People are going to come and say, can you do me a favor? And then you have to be not polite, and you have to say, no, I'm not going to do you a favor. I'm not going to get into a conflict situation. And that's hard to do. That's another counterintuitive thing. So selling to the JEA, being a consultant, working for a company that does business with JEA, your family does any kind of business with JEA, or your business partner contracts with JEA, any kind of those connections. Alert, come and talk to the attorneys to sort you out on this. We do it all the time with city council people. 6, you might be in trouble if you misuse your position, throw your weight around. Do you know who I am? So you got that. But here's some unique things that have come up over the years that didn't seem obvious under this. Going to court with someone, calling a judge. And we had someone just go and sit in a court hearing. Do you know who I am? I'm here with so-and-so. Hope you treat them really nice. I want to get reelected. You know, that's like throwing your weight around, you know, or trying to get a favor for a friend's child. We had someone in Jacksonville where that happened. Hey, really like to get them into a magnet school. Who do you know? No, you can't. Can't be using your connections as good as they are. You can't be using them. Getting a table, parking place, upgrade on a flight, anything using your position. Do you know who I am? I am a humble public servant who wants nothing. That's the answer. Interfering with JEA personnel, coming in, bullying anybody, throwing your weight around, making people feel uncomfortable in JEA. That happens periodically in the city. State ethics offense. You might be in trouble if you vote on an issue in which you have a conflict. You know about that. There's someone out here who wants you to vote on something. You get a direct financial benefit from it, or someone in your family does. Can't do it. So you have to benefit. It must be an economic gain. Lawyers can talk to you about that. Now, the Sunshine Law, our favorite. The Sunshine Law is pretty simple, except for the variations that we get into. Now, you've got that all meetings have to be open and accessible to the public. Take a look, here we are, open and accessible. It was noticed. Meetings are being taken, we're being filmed. This is gonna last forever, this meeting in posterity. You know, so we have done all of this. But when it says that meetings are open and accessible to the public, really, we're talking about your thinking process is open to the public. Isn't that interesting? You know, because you discuss things here, you go back and forth, and there's actually this concept in the law of you come in with a blank slate, an issue is presented to you, you're in shock. You say, why? I don't know how to think about this. And you all start discussing it, and then the opinion emerges. But you didn't know ahead of time. You didn't know ahead of time. Now, that's the thinking process is why outside of these meetings we're so tight on that, and why the courts have ruled against people chit-chatting as you leave this room. It's okay to say anything now that we're on tape, we're being filmed. It's okay now to talk about your opinions with each other. Any other time, no. And that's the simplicity of it. But this falls under subcommittees, 2 people meeting of your group, hiring committees. People don't like to do this for hiring. You know, I like candidate number 2. Oh, I thought candidate number 2 was an idiot. You know, I mean, who wants to do that in the public? It's hard. It's a high standard we have in Florida. 2 people in a planning meeting. Leadership for city council, it's another thing. Who's going to be president? Who's going to be chair? All of it sunshine. Luncheons between meetings. Every time you see one of the people on this board anywhere other than at this table, it's a sunshine issue. You cannot use a person to build a consensus. Now, this is interesting because you've heard that. Well, how does that happen? Like, obviously, I could come and I could talk to Dolores and I could say, you know, here's a JEA issue and I think this is an ethical implication and I really want you to know about this. And then I could go to Alan. I could have the same conversation. And I can't say, Alan, you know, Dolores is really with me on this. Now, Ed, you know, I don't think I can bring him around, you know. You know, you're starting.
I don't know, you knew me so well.
Yeah, well, and so, or, you know, I've actually had people, I'm thinking, God, the ethics officer, you would do. So I go in and I say, you know, I think that this bill, this ethics, the inspector general, is a good idea. And they say, well, what does it look like with the other city council people? I'm thinking, ethics officer, you're, so I use it as a training opportunity. No, you don't ask, are we good? You know, how's it going? You know, so phone meetings. Don't you think with business we could do Skype meetings or conference calls? I mean, we do in our businesses. No. No. Bus tours. No. Because we can't have everybody in the same bus at the same time. Can't do bus tours. Going over agendas, need I say more? Emails. You can't have anything planned ahead of time. Emails after, oh, the Ethics Commission did this. So we pass a fairly complicated resolution. It was late at night. People didn't want to stay around another half hour figuring out the wording. And they said, would you give it to the chair to write the resolution? And then someone said, would you please then email it to everybody so we can all agree upon the revised resolution? No, you can't email after a meeting. Every time you think, it has to be at one of these meetings with everyone here. So no passing around drafts or emails or anything like that. And that's a little counterintuitive because don't we do that in our businesses? You know, so clues. Here's a clue on sunshine because we can't think of every possible way in the universe this could happen. Here's your clue. In our businesses and in my law practice, typically if we have meetings, we want to go to the meeting prepared. We don't want to look like an idiot. So we call people and we say, you know, I'm thinking of bringing up a motion, and here's what I'm thinking. Would you support me in this? Because I need some help with it. Yeah, I'll help you with it. And you kind of test the waters out. That's what we do in businesses, because we don't want to show up, you know, clueless and just like throwing it out and not knowing if we're going to get any support, because we could look stupid. Well, here's how you know if you're violating the Sunshine Law. If you feel uncomfortable coming to a meeting because you have no idea what anyone's thinking, that's probably the best. You don't know. You're thinking, I don't know. I mean, I could throw this idea out and everyone's going to vote against it. You know, you're uncomfortable. If you come into a meeting and you're self-assured that you got a winner for your proposition, how do you know that? How do you know that? You know that because there's been some sunshine violation, typically. So I say the more insecure you are when you throw something out on the table and you don't know how anyone feels, that shows you're following the Sunshine Law. You know, so you don't know. And then you pry your members' feelings on this and you evolve in front of the public as to what your opinion's going to be. Might be in trouble if you destroy any public records, emails, text messages. Even if it's on your personal phone, your personal computer, you have no personal devices anymore. If you write anything pertaining to JEA business, you better be able to retrieve that somewhere. And if your personal computer is like mine and you delete things by mistake, and you can't have your city JEA stuff on your personal devices. It's better to back it up and give it to JEA staff. Take your text messages and use them rarely, if ever. You know what a problem they are. You're truly a problem because people can't figure out how to back them up, and then they drop their phone and they lose them, and the phone companies don't keep them after 3 days. It's a nightmare. So if you're texting, texting even at meetings, how insulting is it to the public when you think about it? They're out there and they see a bunch of texting. They think you're texting on the meeting. You're not. You're texting home. You're texting your daughter. They don't know that. But if you're texting any other members, like, I don't mean to bring up any specific examples, but you will be on the front page of the paper. So, like, I wouldn't text at all. You can email, take your text messages, email them, and forward them to your JEA email. You have JEA emails? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that JEA then backs up all of your emails, but don't keep anything on your private computers, your private cell phones. Don't do it. Every document, everything public business, you have to preserve. If you're like writing at home, you're writing a book on JEA and your experiences, that's a public record. And you better have it available. And when you leave JEA, turn over your public records to the JEA staff. Text messages, just don't text. I mean, I can't. Life and death, like I'll meet you in 10 minutes for lunch, okay. But if you're texting, you can use email just as easily, and it's easier to back up emails. And you might be in trouble if you don't ask questions. You've got a lot of people that want to help you and steer you clear of these things. You've got your top 10 issues. These are the only issues people get in trouble on. So if you kind of think with it, you can eliminate a couple that you'll never get involved with. Focus in on the ones that you have questions on, and then Jody or I or Kirby can give you more of a legal discussion on the things that have cropped up in your universe. Now, I just want to leave with one weakness of boards, and this is the biggest weakness. I think it's really fascinating research. It's the ASH experiment. Has anybody heard about the ASH experiment? You can Google it. It's really interesting. You see Exhibit 2 over there, the line on the left? Which line matches it over in Exhibit 2? A, B, or C?
Looks like A.
Are you sure?
No, because that's an obvious answer for that.
All right, so you can see the actual ASH experiment on YouTube. And so what they did was they had everybody in on it, and this one person would come in, and everybody would say, it's C. And they'd be looking at him, and they'd say, no, it's A. And they'd look at him like, are you crazy? And they do it over and over again to the person, and then pretty soon the person's just agreeing to whatever the group agrees to. And the ASH conformity studies and all of the studies, research that's come from that, fascinating. Because here's the thing. You know, if someone brings up an idea, we're so polite and want to get along with groups, and we didn't get here by being ornery people, you know, so we want to agree. We want to be smooth, and we want to conform. And so what you'll see is a lot of people just saying, okay, we're going to do it this way. You might be thinking, especially new people, I don't know, that doesn't seem right to me. I should say something. Well, I don't know. Maybe I won't. You know, and they've done studies on this. It's fascinating. Most people will just be quiet. But if one person raises their hand saying, you know, I'm a little concerned about this. I don't know. Could you explain it a little more to me? I don't get why it's not A. If one person in the group does that, the whole group will open up the conversation and you'll get more independent thinking. You know, so not to be ornery, but to speak up when you have that situation. So those are my very best topics that I wanted to get across to you. I'm happy we have a couple minutes to answer any specific questions. Kirby and I are always available by phone to go into any of this in depth. And it's a challenge, I'll tell you, it's a challenge. But at least if you can simplify it with this list, I hope it's of help to you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure it will be very helpful. Any questions? Carla? Ed? Burr?
I get a little confused on the document, destroying public records. I thought you could make personal notes to yourself that are not during a meeting that are not public records, but I thought you just said anything during the meeting is a public record, so I'm a little confused by that.
You're statement. Writing a grocery list? You know, obviously that's not going to be a public record, but if you write down anything, it's a personal note to you. You're writing down, remember to bring this up at the next meeting that we need to do A, B, and C and attach that to the contract. It's a personal note that you wrote to yourself, but you're doing it to memorialize your thinking at the time and that it pertains to business in the future. That's a public record, even if it's a private little note to yourself.
So I just now wrote down documents to remember to ask you about that. You're telling me that's a public record?
You're not doing it to memorialize the word document. You're just doing it as a reminder to ask a question. So that would not be.
Okay.
But I would say that when you get to the public records issues, when you pick up pen and start to write, assume it's a public record. Some are not going to be like grocery list or remind to ask Carla after the meeting, blah, blah. You know, you don't want to memorialize that for 2 months and look back. You know, it's just a transitory note that you'll never need again. Anything that's important that you're writing down, assume it's a public record. Maybe there's an exception to it, but most likely the courts rule that it is. They always rule inside of it's a public record. So be careful when you write things down. And sometimes people mix up the transitory and then things that really they do want to remember for the future. So you have to be careful when you're recording that type of thing. You don't write down, chair said something that I think is really stupid because I don't believe it. I mean, that kind of thing is a public record.
No, but I mean, this is what I'm talking about, an example like this. And the yeah. other one, I got a little confused on your three-circle intersection mm-hmm. versus the one later when you talk about if something comes in front of the board and you have a financial gain. That's a clear conflict. But
yes.
When you drew the three circles and you had the intersection there, is that suggesting that if I just know someone who it's a parent of someone at school and I know them through school and they come here for something, I have a conflict? And I have no connection to them whatsoever, I just know them.
The specific voting conflicts are if you have a pecuniary gain, a financial gain that's specific to you. That's when you say, I abstain from voting. When the circles start intersecting, you're looking out and you're seeing someone out there that you know and you've known for 20 years and your kids play ball together, I don't know, you neighbor. All that means with those intersecting circles is that's where you get into trouble if you don't start asking questions and thinking. Obviously, they can sit in the audience and say whatever in public comment, but if they start moving up to the podium and they're asking for something, that's when you have to be on a higher stage of alert. It could be totally fine, depending on the situation, or it could be totally not okay. That's where you go to Jody and say, alert, that person is standing up there and doing whatever. Is that a conflict for me, Jody? And let her decide. You know, now, if it's just someone sitting there waving and saying hello and they know you, that's obviously not going to be a conflict. The intersecting circles are just to show you that those are the categories of where there's going to be a problem. To get into a higher state of alert, it could be fine. Just higher state of alert.
Thank you, Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I know we have a long agenda. I'll keep my question short. I have a law partner who's a state representative. Hypothetically, he asked me for money and asked me to hypothetically be on his host committee. That's not hypothetical. Am I not allowed to send an email to my clients asking them to give money in support of my law partner's campaign? Or should I simply exclude the Marty Fiorentinos and other lobbyists of the world from that mailing list that I might otherwise include?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. And I'll tell you that the campaign and election laws intersect with the ethics laws. And so I'll research that with Jody and get back with you. There's not a simple answer for that. But I would say I would be cautious, you know, especially with lobbyists, because it could be like there's a lot of First Amendment freedoms with campaigns and being able to participate in campaigns. And so you have First Amendment rights. On the other hand, you could be violating some ethics laws.
I'll tell him Carla said I couldn't do it.
Carla said don't give any money or help in the campaign in any way. But I will get back with you on
that,
Alan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gabby?
For the binder materials that we receive as part of our board, what is the appropriate way of retaining those and at some point where we're not necessarily going to go back to them again?
Anything that you're handed out here, the staff has kept copies of, and they've preserved it, hopefully in a digital format. So everything connected with this meeting is already in digital format, so you all don't have to keep your separate copies. What you would keep per meeting is if you have one piece of paper where you're doing your personal notes and observations and things like that and things you want to preserve for the future for your work on the board. That's the public record. So you don't have to keep all the papers that clearly JEA is already retaining because they sent them to you.
Anything else? Paul?
No, I'm good, Mr. Chairman.
Well, thank you, Carla. Kirby, thank you. We appreciate y'all being here.
Thank you, and we'll take off, although I'm sure it's going to be an exciting meeting. And please give Kirby or myself a call if any questions come this afternoon you're thinking about and you have additional questions. We're happy to answer any of them. Thanks.
Do we have your phone number somewhere?
I will have it sent out to everybody. My cell phone, just don't spread it out everywhere. But I'll give you my personal cell phone. Call me anytime.
Okay. Thank you very much. We appreciate you being here.
Thanks.
You helped us to stay on schedule. We appreciate it. We are at item number two. Do we have any discussion or questions before we move off of that agenda item? No need for any action. Just any comments or questions? Okay, thank you. We'll move along to item 2B. And last time I checked, we didn't have any cards from the public. Is anybody from the public here to speak today? So we'll move to item 2C. And I'd like to introduce the Honorable Bill Gulliford, our council liaison. Mr. Gulliford, welcome to the meeting.
Thank you.
Would you like to join us at the speaker's table?
Not particularly.
Okay.
I obviously didn't make the session that you all just went through because I've had a certain amount of that indoctrination.
We understand, sir.
So I beg your indulgence on that. It did make me think or cause pause at the last part of it to remember that the legislature, in their ultimate wisdom, decided to exempt themselves from a number of provisions in the Sunshine Law. And a little bit of hypocrisy there, I do believe. Maybe someday that'll change. Anyway, there's not much going on other than the huge referendum issue that all of you have heard about, and I would urge your support on that. I think it's certainly significant for the entire community that we get this huge pension issue resolved and behind us for the betterment of the community as a whole. So other than that, I don't have much to report. We have our own texting and Sunshine issue.
I thought we were just going to have Mr. Gulliford give us the ethics team.
Thank you, Mr. Gulliford.
Thank you.
We always welcome your attendance and comments and your support in important places. Thank you, sir. Well, we have Dr. Johnny Gaffney with us, Office of the Mayor's Liaison. Dr. Gaffney, you have, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Join us.
I don't have a whole lot. You all know they appreciate the great works that you're doing, the diligence that you have given the others in the community. And we're hearing some very good things about what the board's doing. So you're doing a great job. And as Councilman Board Member Jones and Councilman Gulliford, we've been through quite a few of these. The information is very helpful. Sometimes it can be a little confusing. It's great information, and I think it'll be very useful. Sometimes it takes about 2 or 3 different trainings before you pick it up, but it'll be very beneficial.
Just Ms. Collins, quick learner.
Yeah. She has been very, very, she's very good about meeting with you and answering any kind of questions that you have, so I would encourage all of you out, just pick up the phone and make a phone call. But,
thank you, Dr. Gaffney. We appreciate you being with us. Just for the record, Dr. Gaffney, you will please note that we don't have another Ethics Commission meeting scheduled.
Right. Next year.
Next year. That'd be next year, Chairman, problem. We have our Nassau County Ex Officio Representative, Mike Mullen. Mr. Mullen,
nice
to see
you.
Thanks for being here.
Does that mean I have to give the car back y'all gave me?
That wasn't just.
On behalf of the County Commission of Nassau, they appreciate very much your entire staff and working together to work with Nassau, and so we're delighted to have you here.
Thank you, Mike. We appreciate you being here as well. We have an Arbor Day Foundation tree presentation from Joe Anderson. Is Joe?
Kim Wheeler and Joe Anderson.
Okay.
Yep.
Kim Wheeler?
And Joe.
Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am. We hear you.
Okay. Well, my name's Kim Wheeler, of course, and basically my job just revolves around stopping the outages that don't happen, which occasionally involves removing a tree limb or two from time to time. And historically, we chose to remove the tree limbs discreetly and efficiently thinking our customers would appreciate our quiet benevolence. Well, we realized our customers tended to show more concern for our proactive tree work than our reactive tree work, even if there was an outage. So we had some work to do. We needed to build credibility within our customer base. We needed to tell our story. We were professionals. We do our job very well. We care about our job. We care a lot about our customers. So we started to tell our story. Some of the things we've done, we started off with a new slogan, trimming today maintains power tomorrow. Right tree, right place. Colorful graphics, very pretty magnets for the vehicles, for flyers. We've done, we made luggage tags. You might have those in your envelopes. Our green partnership called Green Relief with Greenscape involves planting at schools, parks around the community. We realize a lot of people don't see us out there when we're digging holes and sweating in the morning from 8 to noon in the middle of a warm fall. So we just leave a mark. We're more visible, more long-term. We've also developed a more robust web presence and even some YouTube videos because we really have an amazing marketing department here at JEA. Very helpful. We organized the JEA Tree Care email and a JEA Tree Care hotline so that our customers can make a call directly to us with their concerns or any questions they may have with the work we do in the community. And Paul McElroy's brainchild, a storyboard. We take that with us to community events, home and patio show. We're taking it to SPAR tonight. It tells people what we do, why we do what we do, and how we do it, with some detailed illustrations and even pictures of our staff working in the field in the community. This is going to be hard to say, but I practiced it several times. We developed some prepaid postage, post-trim survey cards. Couple of years ago, and our first random survey was in the summer covering all the areas of town. We got a 4.1 out of 5 for overall tree trimming experience. So I think the story is working. And all of this rolls into the award we got, the Designated Tree Line Utility USA. And Joe Anderson is the one that applies for it and tracks all the data it's responsible for. So I'm going to let him speak briefly on that award. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim. Welcome, Joe.
Well, I can say regarding business ethics, it's just the right thing to do. And you do have some envelopes in front of you, and they do have a little gift of a treaty acorn in it and some things in the envelopes, and I'm telling you now that it's all under $100. So what this means, this Tree Line USA award, what it means is that for over 5 years, we've been recognized as a Tree Line USA. What that means is for the last 5 years, we've been recognized by the National Arbor Day Foundation and the National Association of State Foresters and our peers as a flagship utility, and not only building gray infrastructure, but green infrastructure. There's only 145 utilities in the nation that qualify, over thousands. There's only 8 in Florida. So what does that mean? That means through our efforts to win this award that we recognize that trees are an essential service just like the other utilities. Think about it for a moment. We're like a tree. A tree takes energy from the sun, and it changes it to chemical energy, and then it distributes it throughout its trunk, throughout its branches, throughout its twigs, throughout its buds, throughout its leaves, throughout its fruits, and its flowers. And it has certain pathways in order to do that. And when it does, everybody benefits. That's exactly what JEA does. We take electrical energy and we distribute it throughout our businesses, our essential services, our public areas, and our homes. And we have certain pathways called right-of-ways in order to do that. And when we do, everybody benefits. So what this means is over the last 5 years, or 5 years in a row, that the power of Jacksonville can be found in a canopy of trees. What this means in the last 5 years, or 5 years in a row, that we have helped make Jacksonville a great place to live, to work, and to play. And what this means for 5 years in a row, that it's always important to us and our commitment to earning customer loyalty, to delivering business excellence,
and developing an unbeatable staff. So what I'd like to do for the staff members who are here of JEA's Vegetative Management, stand up for a moment, be recognized. Some are still out in the field. So I know what we do is something we can be proud of every day, but winning this award makes sure that also that we have a tree canopy that we can always look up to. So in the 2 minutes I have, that's my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for two very good presentations.
Mr. Chairman.
Got it. Thank you. Thank you, Joe. Move to item G, Monica. 2016 J.D. Power Electric Utility Residential Customer Satisfaction Results, Monica Lighting. Hi, Monica.
Good afternoon. Mr. Chairman and members of the board, I am happy to share that I get to present good news today. And I always enjoy doing that. So I have a brief presentation for you on our Wave 3 of our 2016 Residential Electric J.D. Power Customer Satisfaction Awards. The results for Wave 3 came in April. Each year for residential, we have four waves. And for our third wave, JEA hit another record in our history. Wave 3 was the highest wave we've ever accomplished at 720 points. And it also moved us into the top quartile nationally overall. When we look overall, we are also at a record high for JEA at 706 points. Again, when we combine all the drivers. In looking at the blue line, you'll see when we started our journey, we started below 600 points. We are now over 700 points. We have moved almost 100 utilities from where we started our journey. I'll have a slide on that shortly. And again, this puts us in the top quartile, number 28 out of about 138 utilities and 117-point movement. One of the other really exciting things for our residential study, this is the first time in our history that for the residential market, every single one of our drivers for Wave 3 was in the top quartile nationally. For our year to date, we are in the first quartile for billing and payment, corporate citizenship, communication, and customer service. We are on the top of the second quartile for power quality and reliability and price, only within 4 to 5 points from being in the first quartile, and that is our goal. Our goal is to be in the top quartile for every driver and the top quartile nationally. This chart, while I understand it is an eyesore, I think it is a very important visual reminder of where we started our journey. We started our journey back in 2012 at the very bottom of the fourth quartile. The utility at the bottom of the quartiles right now is 607 points. The top utility is at 760 points. We are at 706 points. So again, for perspective, it's been a 117-point movement, but there really only is about a 160 or so points in there, and we've moved over 100 of those points. So really fantastic and moving ahead of almost 100 utilities. So what were our top movers? What were the key things that have helped us move further from our 2015 to where we are year to date? It would be in the area of power quality and reliability with 17 points. Kudos to Mike's team, teams like Kim that just presented, as well as some of Mike's others' team, with avoiding lengthy outages. Our customers have reported that that's been a big area of improvement, and certainly our capital commitment to our infrastructure, as well as our commitment to our trees and our transmission lines, help in that. Equally, keeping customers informed about outages, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in my operations report. That has been a big focus of improving how we service our customers and how we communicate to our customers in times of an outage. We also had a big movement, 14 points in price, with our customers feeling the fairness in pricing has improved, as well as our efforts to help manage usage. Again, we've been able to offer fuel credits, fuel rate reduction, communicating to our customers that JEA's electric rates are the third lowest in the state of Florida, and also that we work to help customers know how to manage and control their bill, and that is very important to them in their sense of fairness on price. And then finally, in corporate citizenship, being involved in our community. We have about 800 employee volunteer activities every year. Our employees donate of their time and their money and give to local charities as well, and helping plan for the future. And our customers all recognize that, and those were our big movers from 2015 to 2016 so far. Oops. Did I do that? Oh, there we go. And then a final chart for summary, again, just pointing out our journey. Great performance for Wave 3 that puts us in the first top quartile nationally, number 28 out of 137 utilities. We moved up ahead of two Florida utilities, so we're now number 4 out of 11 for the residential market, and really proud of that movement. We will have our Wave 4 results for you in July, and that'll be our year-end results, and we are looking for and do need a strong Wave 4 performance for that. On the business market, again, you're aware of our trophy, our number one ranking. I'm also happy to share with you today a letter that we received in the mail, and Mike Hightower can tell you that funny story later of how he shared it with me. But we did receive a letter from Governor Rick Scott recognizing JEA, our J.D. Power Business Award, and the important role this plays in our community, in the region, and for the state of Florida, and his recognition and congratulations to JEA's employees, the board, and our customers for this. So with that, if there's any questions.
Have any questions of Monica?
Monica.
This is a board of competitors.
Yes, sir.
And I think they would probably appreciate seeing the list of 11 utilities in the state that are 6 behind us and 3 in front of us. Is that what
yes.
you said? At some point in the
I
future.
Can certainly include that in my next update. Yeah. And if you'd like, I have my operations report later. I can actually at least verbally provide it. I'll go through the eye chart and have that verbally. Yeah. But
does
we'll
that mean there are 11? 11
total
in the
Florida,
state of Florida
utilities. Mm-hmm.
That we can be with? Okay.
Yes.
Other comments? Thank
Great
you, Mark.
Very good. Thank you.
Let's see. We are on item 3, Roman numeral 3, the consent agenda, items 1 through 4. I'd like a motion and a second to approve.
Move approval.
Second.
Any discussion about anything we need to talk about at this point? If not, we'll all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you. We'll move to item 3B, strategic discussions and actions, and we have Angie Hires as our number one presenter.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and Board of Directors. Okay. In your packets, you should have an agenda item summary and as well as an interoffice memorandum with the subject of JEA 401A Defined Contribution Retirement Plan Restatement Resolution 2016-10. This particular information is currently provided as information only as well as for your review. However, at our June 21st board meeting, the staff will recommend that the board approve these documents for implementation and also give our CEO and managing director the authority for us to execute these documents. From a frame of reference, the JEA 401A plan was established back in 2002, and this particular plan was established in order to allow appointed employees or non-civil service system employees the opportunity to defer compensation into this plan on a tax-deferred basis. Also, from a standpoint of information, this particular plan, we have Mass Mutual, a life insurance company, that serves as the trust and plan document provider for us, and that pretty much sums it up. They pretty much help us from a standpoint of putting the documents together, helping us with the administration of the plan, And whenever there's any changes to the document or the plan, they help us get those documents together to be submitted to the IRS. Also, from a standpoint of that plan, we have an investment committee, and that particular committee is made up of employees within JEA who have a background in investments as well as finances, and they serve on that committee to help sort of oversee the committee and also the investments. We have employees who are participants of that plan. They're able to go in and select their own investment options as being a part of that plan. We also have our HR department from a benefits perspective that on a daily basis they administer the plan, such as doing the deductions for the compensation that is deferred, making sure that any forms that are associated with the plan are executed, of course, paying the administrator from the funds that are put into the plan. Periodically, as laws change, as there are different things that may occur that may cause amendments to the plan, we are required and is also recommended by attorneys as well as other pension attorneys that you go in and restate that plan document. With MassMutual serving as our trust and document provider, they will submit to the IRS for us any of the laws that have changed regarding that particular plan. They recently did that, and they received a favorable letter from the IRS stating that it was still a qualified plan. However, there are certain amendments that needed to be made regarding changes that had been made in law. In particular, it was the pension law that went into effect in 2006. As a result of that, with them receiving the favorable letter and they being the trust and plan document provider for JEA, at this time what we would need to do was to reinstate the plan, restate the document, and as a part of this particular plan, we have to present that to the board for their review and approval in order for us to implement that into JEA and carry out that plan. This particular implementation is cost neutral, meaning because it's just changes in the law as it relates to how these plans are governed, there's no cost to the organization. Because this is for appointed employees, it does not involve any type of bargaining with any of the bargaining units. The only thing that is required that we do implement any of the laws that have changed, make any of the amendments that are associated with it, and have approval for the board. So again, at this time, we're presenting to you this to you as a means of information to give you an opportunity to review the documents. They are somewhat voluminous. It is the plan document as well as the advisory letter that was issued to MassMutual from the IRS, as well as the restated document itself. So, if there are any questions.
Questions of Angie on this material? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
And no action required on that presentation. And we have a approval of a resolution on the financial 2016 budgetary transfers from Melissa Dykes. Melissa, welcome. And Mike Brooks. Mike, welcome.
Good afternoon. Mike and I are going to tag team on this item. The first portion of this, and this is presented for board action this afternoon. The first portion of the discussion is the budgetary transfers that are being requested for approval at this time. When the board approved our fiscal year 2016 budget, it approved a capital budget for the electric system of $170 million. Within that capital budget that was approved, there are actually four separate buckets of capital improvement program line items. Up to $5 million of transfers can be executed by our CEO under a delegation from the board. But at this time, we are requesting transfers of $12.86 million related to repairs needed at the Brandy Branch Generating Station. Those transfers will not increase the total capital budget. The total capital budget remains $170 million. These are transfers within the CIP line items for the electric system capital budget. So I will turn it over to Mike to talk about why we need the transfers.
Yeah. Thank you, Melissa. So mentioned this in some prior meetings. We did have a large planned outage this spring out at Brandy Branch. It started on March 1st, and it was supposed to be a two-month project, and we still haven't gotten it back in, so it's gone into the, obviously, into the third month. It was originally budgeted at $13.5 million, and based on what we found when we opened up the equipment and units, we had to add both cost and schedule to the scope of the project, and that resulted in the need for the CIP transfer that Melissa mentioned. We have a single combined cycle unit. It's a certain type of technology. It uses combustion turbines. So at Northside and SGRPP and Plant Shearer, we have steam turbines, which produces steam to turn the generator. Combustion turbines are like a jet engine to turn the generators. Instead of attaching the engine to the wing of a plane, it's attached to a foundation, so it's stationary, of course, and spins the generator. It's a combustion, so it's not steam, and it generates very, very hot exhaust temperatures. Those exhaust gases can be captured and used to make steam. That's what makes it a combined cycle unit. We actually have five other large combustion turbines that are simple cycle, so when you capture that waste heat and steam and run it through a steam turbine generator, that's what makes it a combined cycle. It is our most efficient generator, and in the industry it's extremely efficient, and of course it runs on natural gas, so when it's on available, it's base load. Brought the unit online, commercial operation in 2004, so about 12 years ago, invested $560 million in it, and it makes, it's got a capacity of 525 megawatts in the summer and 100 megawatts additional in the winter. The combustion turbines themselves, again, they're like jet engines. After 24,000 hours of operation, that you have to take them down for a major outage, major rebuild overhaul, and we were simply due at Brandy Branch for that work. This particular outage also included the first inspection and major overhaul on the steam turbine generator, which is a 10-year cycle. So that was the scope of work going in. This is a shot of the rotor, combustion turbine rotor. We have two of these, one in each unit. It's being lifted by a crane. It's 125,000 pounds, 60 tons. It's being lifted and put onto a trailer to take to GE's repair facility in South Carolina. This was not part of the scope going in. This was based on what we found when we got into the units. The combustion turbine rotor has two sections. There's a compressor on the left, so it brings in outside air and compresses it down to a high PSI, adds fuel, and then there's a combustion. So the thrust from the combustion goes left to right from the center out through those blades. So that's the hot gas path on the right. Going into the outage, we had known for a couple of years now that we have some cracks on the compressor blades. So the blades on the left of that previous photo was something we were aware of, monitoring, working with GE. We knew about it. We were not going to do anything with the compressor blades in this outage. We were going to tackle that in 2019, the next time we have a planned outage. However, what we did find was some unknown, as-found cracks on the rotor, the hot gas path section, which were significant and severe. We couldn't put it back in operation and without dealing with it. So again, this entire unit had to go off to GE's repair facility in South Carolina to work on the hot gas path section on the right. We went ahead and made the decision to take care of the compressor blades at the same time. There was no sense in putting it back in service with half the problem fixed, only to have to ship it off to GE repair facility in 2019. We went ahead and picked up that additional scope of work. $3.8 million was for the repair on the hot gas path times two. There's two rotors, and then so that was new. The $3 million for the compressor blade repair work was known, but what we did was we pulled it up three years early. And that is the story. We're in the process, as we speak, of bringing back one of the two combustion turbines. So we'll have half of the 500 megawatt unit this week. And then in a few more weeks, GE still has the other rotor up in South Carolina. And questions for me on this?
Questions? Alan?
Mike, you said this was a fleet issue GE was aware of. Were they covering any of the cost?
No.
Good question. They have lots of fleet issues, and it's long since out of warranty. And I might add that they have competitors in the industry that have similar issues. These things run at over 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. The metallurgical requirements are significant, and after 12 years of operation, it's not uncommon in the industry to have these kind of issues. The compressor problem was very well known throughout the industry.
It's 2,000 degrees, and it's spinning at what RPMs?
3,600
RPMs, yeah. And it's 60 tons.
Mike, if we're dealing with unforeseen issues here, obviously we need to do this, but is this causing any kind of capacity issue as to what our run capabilities are with this out longer than maybe expected?
No capacity issues. It's been a mild year. It's beginning to get hot right now, but we've got plenty of capacity for this time of year.
So we'll get it back in time?
No capacity issues.
Hussein?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I see the request is to move over the $12.86 million. So what are we deferring that we budgeted for? And are there any issues with what we're deferring?
Good question. I don't know that there's a whole lot of specifics. We manage the portfolio in total. When this popped up, we went to work making sure that we could work this in. We had a fair amount of money in the budget for the facility work this year that was pushed out. There's other discretionary items that can be moved around. In terms of transmission distribution projects, the dates on those are soft, and we've deferred some work to 17 without an adverse impact. So we were able to push some things around.
So it's the type of projects that, like when you're targeting your semi-5 strategy and stuff like that, we're just pushed back one fiscal year.
It's a good example of the semi-5 work is important but discretionary, so that we could cut back on that some.
Okay. Other questions? About a motion and a second to approve this.
So moved.
I'm sorry, Warren.
What's the life of Mike of those turbines once they rehab?
You know, they're almost totally rebuilt every 24,000 hours. You pull about half of what's in them, the blades out, and replace and refurbish them and put them back in. I think 30 years is probably a good life expectancy in total, assuming you take care of them and maintain them on a proper schedule. 30 years, 40 years.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move the
motion.
Capital budget second. Line item transfer.
A motion and second. Discussion? Mr. Burr.
My discussion is more on the reason why this is in front of us and if this is an appropriate level. The base I can see this, which I have $170 million, or at least in the 2017 budget, CIP budget that we approve. You have four categories. The CEO is authorized to make operational issues up to $5 million, which is a small percentage point. It's maybe my question goes to, this seems like awful close to operations that we're starting to get into, and I'm not sure. Maybe I'd ask for management or our finance and audit committee to review the policy on whether $5 million is appropriate and whether at this level it should all be coming to the board for approval. Or maybe just the finance committee or something else. It just seems like we're a little bit in the operational weeds with this thing. So I'm just asking that. I'm fine with the motion itself, but I really may beg the question on why are we dealing with it at this level. And as long as the CIP budget doesn't change, it seems to me there could be more latitude for management to approve transfers within that CIP budget. But I just put that as a thought.
We have the chairman of the finance and audit committee and the CEO nodding, so I'm sure that we'll take this up at the next to Finance and Audit Committee.
Absolutely. I think that sounds like a great idea.
Thank you.
Other discussion? Thanks. Being no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you. You've approved item B2. Thank you, Melissa and Mike.
Thank you.
Now we have the bi-monthly operations presentation from Brian and Mike and Monica.
Good afternoon. We'll start off with safety and then move to the water for about approximately 10 minutes. And on safety, next, recordable incident rate, that's the OSHA measurable metric. We are at 1.7 year to date compared to our target at 1.2. What that represents is 1.7% or 1.7 employees every 100 undergoes a OSHA recordable incident on an annual basis, so a work year of 2,080 hours. If you look at comparison of that, in comparison from last year, we had 21 recordables year to date, and we're at 20 year-to-date this year. The rate this year at 1.7, last year at 1.65 this time. So right in line we were last year. The purpose of this metric is for safety, but it does also tell you while we have one less incident, a higher rate tells you that we have less work hours as a utility this year. Therefore, it's a offshoot analytical procedure that helps you know that we're actually running the utility of less work hours and a little bit of efficiency this year. Back to safety, five of our incidents have been lost time, and those are the most concerning ones. With the injuries are spread across electric with 800 employees directly in electric, 500 in water, 12 in electric injuries, 6 in water, and 1 or 2 in the other groups is pretty well the spread that's historically been at JEA. We want to increase our focus on complacency. Those are especially items that people can get severe hurt. Hand and finger sprains, our safety group does a wonderful job on looking at the patterns we have. Did a great job of getting work gloves instituted out for different purposes. There's probably hundreds of different gloves out there, but we have about 10 different ones we're using. Nice portables explain why you use different gloves for different jobs, and safety does a great job of that because we have a lot of hand and finger issues that we're trying to prevent. Strains, sprains, slips, falls, and then 0 to 5 year employees and new employees, we have more injuries related to that. And we do want to remind everyone that while we're not in our target of 1.2, we are doing very good compared to industry benchmarks. LPPC, which is a large public power, is average of 3.7, and JEA is at 1.7 right now. But our plan is to be at 0. Everyone go home safe every day. The next slide, I just love the slide. It shows where we are in water usage over the last decade. We were at 43 billion gallons 10 years ago, approximately in 07. We're at 33, 34 billion gallons of water the last 2 years. So that's approximately a little bit over 20% reduction in the last 10 years where we're at. We're kind of stabilizing that 33, 34 billion as we speak, even though we're growing customers. Wastewater is the dark blue. And you see wastewater is moving up a little bit at 26 or 27 billion. And 1 year, Melissa and I are going to have a reclaim number here. We're at 5 billion gallons, of reclaim. So the scale is not quite right to put it on there yet, but reclaim keeps on growing. Year to date, we're at 3.6% increase from last year. The next 5, 6, 7 months, or the last 5 months of the year with rainfall and sort of a lot of customers use a reclaim irrigation, but still a lot of customers use potable water on irrigation. So we don't see the driver really being weather this year yet, but we'll see. The big driver is, great news, is more connections. We have over 8,000 new connections from this time last year in water, and 1,800 more reclaim connections. So the growth is, that's about 2.5% growth rate. 325,000 meters last year, 333,000 this year. Significant growth rate. We'll go into our customer reliability metrics. This is a stretch goal. We're at 3345 year-to-date unplanned water main outages compared to our target 4,500. You can see in FY14 and 15, and then I know from prior years, we've never met that goal. We'll be close if we have a good last 5 months. We were challenged coming out of the box on the first quarter. We had 21 inches rainfall in those two quarters, the last quarter of last year and the first quarter of this year. But you see the first 4 months of the calendar year, which is quarter two, and the year to, or quarter to date, quarter three, we're doing real good on the number of unplanned water main outages to our customers. The next measurement's excellent. We'll see probably a little uptick a little bit next few months. This shows you when pressure is less than 30 PSI, and basically that's what a shower wants or a kitchen sink. They want 30 PSI at the kitchen sink. So if you have 30 in the street, you're not going to quite get it. So we realize that 30 is really a minimum for people to be acceptable. But that's 1 minute per month, 1 or 2 minutes per month, across 110 miles all across town. And you think about it, basically 1 or 2 minutes out of 43,000 minutes a month that people have less than 30 PSI of water available to use safely. The last bottom is really just looking at our workforce and our response time. I think we talked about it at previous meetings, 67 minutes on average response time. If you call up JEA, 18,000 opportunities year to date to win over customers. And it's amazing that any customer service group that rolls trucks and goes to people's houses can respond in 67 minutes, a lot better than a lot of other peer groups. We won't mention my cable bill I got yesterday. That went up $20.
That's not even fair comparison.
I know, it really isn't. It went up $25. I'm already cutting the cord. So I thought that was fair. So Environmental compliance, first we'll look at the water system. This is our consumptive use permit. We're 5 years into this 20-year consumptive use permit with St. John's River Water Management District. On the first one is a couple limit across the whole service territory. We're at 100 million gallons a day year to date, and our limit is 131 million gallons a day on average, so we're well within that limit. The second one, South Grid well fuel allocation, which is a more of a stringent requirement under our South Grid. We're at 44 million gallons a day, and our limit is 50.23. What we're doing there, and you look at the three rectangular boxes in the second inset slide, what you see is in 2013, there was a blank spot, what we call Greenland. So we were using about 14 million gallons a day across those three plants, but Greenland didn't exist at that point in time. So then we move in 2016, you still have that rectangle box. We're using 12 million gallons a day, a little bit less, but it's across three plants. So we're working with our 83 wells in the South Grid and our 15-ish plants and trying to spread the usage of the water versus just going direct, coming a limited number of plants, and therefore sustain the aquifer for a longer period of time. We also have three new wells getting built at Main Street over the next 2 years. We'll produce over 7 million gallons a day of water that would go across our river crossings. That also helps supply this long-term for growth. The bottom right-hand slide is our reclaim. The threshold numbers, the horizontal 32, 37, 44 MGDE are limits or thresholds in our cup that if we reach those thresholds, then our overall cup gets increased. It does not help the South Grid specifically, but it helps the overall cup. It allows us to do more transfers. We're not going to meet the 32 in 2020. Right now we're at 13 MGD. We'll be up 15 MGD by the end of the year. Where we started on reclaim was about 2,000, and we're at 15 now. So we're basically have increased 1 MGD a year for the last 15 years on average, and it's been fairly steady. And by 2020, we plan on being about 20 MGD, so about 1 million gallons a day. You think about where we were 15 years ago, there was no reclaim. We have one of the biggest reclaim systems on the South Grid when we built that with new development, and 26 miles worth of pipelines north-south, and a lot of them going east to west. We continue to leverage reclaim as we go forward. The next one, environmental compliance on the wastewater side. The first chart is our total nitrogen discharge to the river. Several meetings ago, Vice Chair Burr asked about here. We were projecting right around 600 at a time, and I was getting pushed on, why are we at 600? You've been producing 550, previous years. We made it through the winter. Nitrogen's tougher to operate during the winter, more variability, and we're projecting 568 now. I'm comfortable to say that. We had good, our methodology is consistent, but we had hoped that we would have a good winter. We are actually treating more wastewater in previous years, and we'll be right at what we've done the last 2 years, about 553 and 577. We'll be in that range. About a 20% margin under our limit at 683, so we know we can meet our commitments and the commitments to the city. The second one, SSO events, Saratoga Sewer Overflows. We're at 25 year to date. The average shows over the last 8 years 30, and that average word is almost misleading because that's exceptional performance. It's average mathematically over the last 8 years, but to have 4,000 miles, 1,350 pump stations, even 25, anywhere in the range of that 30-40 is exceptional compared to our benchmark utilities across the country and on overflows per mile, overflows per pump station, overflows per customers, and JEA is a leader in that. The last one tracks our volume. We've talked about the larger hit we had earlier. So to wrap up, two slides left on our financial results. Our revenues, $428 million, about a 2.5% increase over the budget that we expect, but it's stable. The revenues are stable in the water sewer system. The O&M, we're estimating $134 million, probably coming a couple million dollars lower, especially we have no storm events, hurricanes or anything like that. We have and we mentioned storm events because we're going through the hurricane exercise this week at JEA all week long, going preparing for that, and we want to prepare, but we hopefully do not have a hurricane, but we probably coming in low 130s there. And the last one is our, in yellow, is our capital, because that's really we're focusing a lot on our capital budget, $163 million. We'll be in that 150 range. 2 years ago, FY14, we were 77. Last year, we were 100. We'll be this 150, 160 range this year and closer to 200 next year delivering projects. We have projects, just to summarize, all across town, water, wastewater, reclaim. We have treatment plants, pump stations, reclaim. We're expanding capacity. We're doing large R&R. We're even doing a lot in St. John's County, and we have our ex officio member in Nassau County. Next 5 years, we have $20, $30 million worth of work in Nassau County in that service territory. And 16 seconds over, but the slide here, we keep on moving favorable here. We're left of the median. look forward to today. Those two left are going to jump JEA one day because we're not moving up for quite a while. So any questions?
Very good. Any questions? Comments?
All right, we'll go ahead and move into some similar signs for the electric system. Better results, but...
excellent plus is good.
Competitive, Mr. Chairman.
Brian and I compete for who can spend the less capital each year. Our budget's around 160, just like his budget, and who can pay down the most debt quickly enough. Unit sales have come down over the last, from 7 to 11, 12, and have pretty much flattened out on the electric side. Similar growth in meters on the electric versus water, but on a annual megawatt hour sales, down or flat. Predominantly driven by weather. You can see there that year to date, this year versus last year, we're 9% behind on heating degree days, cooling degree days. So I'll recall the very, very mild winter we had this year, for example. So we are 1.5% behind last year in terms of year to date. If we end up at 12.175, that's about a 2% reduction year over year, for the most part flat and weather related. Our T&D grids, good presentation earlier, good results from Kim Wheeler and Joe. Doing a good job tree trimming, which helps with reliability, and also if they approach it properly, they can help us with customer satisfaction. Monica talked a little bit about the J.D. Power's customer sat results, and a lot of that is embedded in the key metrics here on this slide. Outage frequency and duration running at 1.789. The duration is up a little bit this year, but it's a little less than it was last year, so it's not significantly in trouble. We went from customers experiencing more than five outages a year. We went from 2 years ago at 3.5%, dropped down to a very impressive 1% or less late last year in the first quarter of the fiscal year. It's come back up to around 2% in the recent months. A lot of that is weather-related, storm-related. What's important to watch there, I think, is just the trend over time that we continue to work that down. Transmission line reliability is very impressive. If you go all the way back to fiscal 08 and see the significant improvement in that particular metric, 1.6 year-to-date against a target of 3. Our generating fleet continues to have excellent results in terms of reliability. 1.4 forced outage rate is top decile in the industry, and you can see that that's spread pretty evenly across the fleet, in line with where we have been running over the last 5 years, and significantly improved from the 08, 2009, 2010 years. We have seen we went a couple of months with no reportable events on the environmental side. Had one in January at Northside with a fuel oil spill that we were able to contain. Had one the next month at SGRPP with a hydraulic line out on the coal terminal on the water that sprung a leak. And then in April we had some petroleum coke as one of our solid fuels. Some dust got away from the barge unloading area and got into the river with some sheen. So these are fairly small and contained, but we report them to the Coast Guard, we report them to DEP. So we count those in our list of key electric production power plant indicators. Year to date, we'll forecast to budget. We're $70 million short on revenue, and $87 million short year over year, and that's all in the fuel line item. That's the fuel refunding we did at the beginning of the fiscal year, plus the rate reduction, and you can see a corresponding favorable variance on the expense side, again, for fuel, $60 million less than last year with comparable unit sales, and $80 million less than budget. So netting out, we're $44 million favorable to budget, and just slightly worse than last year. You see the capital expenditure line item? We had set a goal at the beginning of the year, 153.2. And you can see now we're forecasting the 165.5. That's reflective of the addition for the combined cycle outage that we talked about earlier. And you can see we've still got $5 million margin against the 170 cap limit. On the electric costs metric, we are not doing well this year. The target of 49.44 is based on last year's actual. And if you look at the cost components there, we're up on capital year over year. We're up a little bit on O&M year over year, and we're we're down on unit sales in the denominator, so we're currently forecasting about a 10% over target on that metric. The financial metrics are in good shape. Expect to end the year with $3 billion in debt, paying down $150 million in principal. Our fuel fund is very healthy. Started the year with 151. We did the 57 fuel credit, and even with the rate reduction from a couple of months ago, we're still expecting an $88 million surplus, so that nets out to plus 30, so we'll grow the balance by about $31 million is the current forecast. And that's where we stand on clearly in the below the median. Number three in this comparison group in terms of Florida cities, significantly lower than Gainesville, Pensacola on the right, and close to number two. And of course, as is the case on the water side, no rate increases, fuel or base anticipated. Other folks are looking at increases, and the reduction in the fuel fund this year has dropped us, the fuel rate has dropped us down into that favorable position at the bottom. Questions for me?
Any questions for Mike? Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. And Monica's up next. Who are we behind?
Hello, Monica.
I've got it right
I
here.
Hello again.
Please proceed.
Oops. There we go. Okay, for our customer operations report today, this is the report card that we share with you every month, and as I already shared, we had a very strong third wave in year to date. But if you're interested in some more of the specifics, where we landed per wave, how it aligns with our strategy, that information is here for you. Mr. Chair, to your question, and we will have a slide for this moving forward in the ops report, but the order of the utilities, SECO, which is the Sumterville Electric Co-op, is number one at 763, followed by FPL, Clay, and then JEA, when you look in the order. Then OUC, Gulf Power, Lee County Co-op, with Lacoochee Electric Co-op, Tampa, Duke Electric Florida, Lakeland, and then Lakeland Electric. So that would be the order of the Florida utilities, and we'll have more information on that in the future with their scores and ranking and the spread. The lowest Florida utility is at 648, ranked at 119. The highest is at 763, ranked at number one. So as we move into our strategy and our areas of focus and then the drivers of customer satisfaction, in the area of be easy to do business with for our different channels, we work to provide our customers various channels of how they want to do business with us. Right now, the very good news is that nearly 80% of our transactions and channels are done through automated or self-service through our phone IVR, the interactive voice response system, or through our website at jea.com. And our customer satisfaction rankings from JD Power, based on those channels, are doing well. JD Power also recently did a national website study, and JEA performed quite well. You'll see we ranked in there at number four nationally in the top quartile. Likewise, in the Wave 3 conference call, JEA was identified as a top performer, with highest phone satisfaction nationally being number three. First contact resolution is something we watch very closely. This basically is in all of our channels, no matter how our customers do business and transact with us, we're working to do things accurately right the first time. This has been an area we've put a lot of focus on since 2012. We are continuing to improve. We're doing better this year than we were last year. We monitor our customer feedback. You'll see that drop in February of 2016. We went in, we looked at the comments, we found that we had an issue in our IVR system, we were able to fix it, and then again, we rebound. So again, the voice of the customer, monitoring that data is very important, and we're doing well there. Power quality and reliability. This is a new area. All of these metrics are new for us. This is in our outage communication. Back in November of 2015, we launched a new outage communication system, a new website, a new outage map, where customers can report outages through our website, through text, through the IVR, much more automated. We also are doing much more in the information that we provide customers during an outage and different channels and how we can get their updates. So what we're seeing here, which we're happy to report, is that a large majority, again, 75% to 80% of our customers are reporting outages through automated systems, which is great because nothing's more frustrated when you're experiencing an outage and having a large hold time on the phone. While we have not yet done a lot of marketing on it, customers are already using our text and our map and JEA.com to report outages. We're working the bugs out as we get into storm season. You're going to see a lot more in communicating there. Customers receiving outage updates. This is a new metric. What we know is that the more customers who experience outages that receive status updates along the way, and the number of data points between 4 and 6, for instance, we're aware of your outage, the crew is en route, the crew is on site, here's the number of people out, estimated restoration time. So we work very closely with Mike's team and the field folks that as we're getting that information, it gets updated in the system, and those updates go to the customers that have requested the updates. And so we're seeing that number grow. And we're also seeing the use of our outage communication, our outage map growing, which is fantastic news because then we can have greater satisfaction. The first wave of J.D. Power in 2016 that actually had these tools available was Wave 3. In Wave 3, we performed in the top quartile for outage communication, specifically around data points and some other items. So that was great news for us, showing that our tools are working and customers are responding. So we look forward to keep monitoring that. For our billing and payment options, we're really doing fantastic in our participation. We're getting much closer to our industry averages, and this has been an ongoing effort of ours. We have almost doubled participation rates in our program since we started looking at this in 2013. And so we're having some nice success there. Fun fact, we actually are JEA e-bill subscribers. From what is being saved in paper, have saved nearly 20,000 pounds of paper and 72,000 pounds of wood every year. For our communications, again, we work very hard at communicating direct with our customers on the topics that they want to be communicated with. We saw a strong bump again in wave three of enhanced communication. As we are getting into one of our high bill peak seasons with our hotter weather, we did focus our communications in May on energy and water efficiency for our customers, as well as sending customers a YouTube video on our tracker and how they can manage their bill. And I'll have that to share with you shortly. As far as corporate citizenship goes, employee volunteering, we're at about close to 500 employees that have volunteered in different activities in the community, and over 100 ambassador events. I wanted to call out on John Babick. I thought his story was great, director of electric compliance. And he volunteered for recently the Habajacks, and we had crews from JEA employees who volunteered and did some of the building of Habajacks. What I think is really great about John's story is why he volunteers for Habajacks. John immigrated to the United States as a teenager, and one of his very proud moments was when he and his wife were able to purchase their first home and they had saved for it. And so to him, giving back of his time to help build homes and help other people have that dream of home ownership is really personal to him. And I just thought that was a beautiful story and sharing the heart of some of our employees. So for also our energy efficiency focus, we have a lot of programs that we've talked about before. Our progress is moving well with our rebates, our electric vehicles, our low income energy efficiency improvements. And you'll see our customers are showing in their awareness and familiarity of the programs. Uh-oh. I don't know what that is. I think that was for the video. Okay. Can you just advance it? We'll go ahead and skip that. I had a video on Tracker to show. It's a video for how customers can log on online and see their usage. That is on YouTube if you're interested. And then corporate citizenship. Again, we continue our work with nearly 30 local nonprofits. Federal, state, local dollars, over $1.6 million has been provided in assistance to some of our customers who are struggling. Mm-hmm. So we'll just skip that. And then for our continuous improvement, just a lot of the efforts that were on our website, automating for my budget, a lot of these pieces of feedback come from our customers and from our surveys, and so we listen to that and we work to make improvements. For my budget, it will be going on the website momentarily in the next week, where customers will be able to log on or apply for my budget online. They'll get their estimated amount, an immediate sign up, confirmation, and that was all feedback that came direct from our customers, as well as enhancements to our weather map with the high and low, and putting more information so people can correlate their usage with weather, because that is such a big tie. And we've gotten some really nice feedback on that as well. The video that I had shared with you, I'll just share the story. We had a group of employees. I was going to end on a good note with it being a long day of presentations for you. We had a group of employees that learned how to crochet and used their lunchtime as a group and made blankets and donated them to the pediatric wards of local hospitals. And I think, again, just examples, this was not something that really JEA asked them to do. It was just something they really take our values and our giving back and being a local community-owned utility and wanting to do that. So, again, if you're on YouTube, it's called Crocheting for a Cause, and it's really a beautiful story.
Very good. Any questions of Monica? Thank you, Monica. Very good report. Congratulations on all your good report.
Thank you.
Good job. We're at 3C, which is other new business. Do we have any other new business? Being none, we will ask for old business. Or any old business? No old business? We'll move to reports. We have our Finance and Audit Committee report. Kelly Flanagan, Committee Chair. Kelly, please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and also specific thank you for stepping in during the Finance and Audit Committee meeting last week. Really thank appreciate your assistance in that manner. The first order of business, given that we had some committee members participating by phone, is to approve the minutes of the meeting. If I can have
the so motion. Moved.
Yeah, well, you go ahead.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Wanted to brief the board. All of our committee materials have been included in the board materials, but wanted to give specific recognition to the finance staff, which have put in a tremendous amount of effort into the budget preparation for the coming fiscal year. This is something that's going to be presented to the entire board at next month's meeting, and wanted to thank them for all of their time and efforts on that. In addition, the other primary topic that I wanted to address with the board is the procurement for the external auditor process. The finance committee has done a tremendous job with the benchmarking activities of large power public council members through this process, and in identifying external auditors to other public power utilities, the management staff has recommended 6 firms to pursue with our request for proposal for external audit services, given that our current services of E&Y are through June 30th of 2017. I think that They did a wonderful job on the benchmarking activities and fully supportive of their recommendation to move forward with that request for proposal. Other topics discussed in the committee meeting included reports from Audit Services, our Chief Information Officer, report on Identity Theft Protection, Ethics Officer's Quarterly Report, Electric and Water Reserves Report, and our Energy and Energy Market Risk Management Report. And we've had conversations with our current auditors of ENY, and everything is progressing as planned with the audit, and no issues have arisen at this time.
Any questions from our board? Thank you, Kelly. Very good report. We'll move to Alan Howard, Committee Chair for Government Affairs Committee. Alan?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Board Committee of Government and Legal Affairs met on May 6, 2016, at which time we considered and adopted for recommendation to this board a proposed charter with certain changes to the draft that was previously circulated. That's included in the board materials, the revised charter, and I'd ask for a vote on that, Mr. Chair.
We'll take that as a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion on the motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Mr. Chairman.
We also received a report on current litigation matters from Jody Brooks, our liaison from the Office of the General Counsel. Those are also included in the board matters. We discussed at some length the more significant litigation, which is concerning ash product previously sold by JEA, and which is scheduled for mediation in Mississippi this week. That's also included for information. If anybody has questions about that, they should direct them to Jody, not me.
Any questions of Jody?
Sunshine paid off.
Yeah, it worked.
We also received a report from the Chief of Public Affairs, Mr. Mike Hightower, on the JEA's local, state, and federal legislative and regulatory matters, and the team that he has assembled to address and manage those on a proactive basis for JEA. And that material is also included in the board book. And I would also direct questions regarding those materials to Mr. Hightower, if anyone had it. We'll schedule another meeting of the Government and Legal Affairs Committee as needed and announce that at our next board meeting. That's our report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Excellent report. We'll ask our Managing Director, CEO, Paul McElroy, for his report. Paul?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Two quick points. I just wanted to talk about trees one more time. You know, when I first had the honor of taking this job, the first 6 months dealt with nothing but trees and tree canopies and tree butchery and all of the communities around the area just out there. And I just want to, again, publicly thank Kim and her leadership. And we revised the entire contract and really worked with customers. And right now, it's just positive feedback. And council was involved. I was called to council a number of times on trees. But we're really doing well for the community, and it's showing in our numbers. I, we recognize here a little storm just rolled in. I want to say it's almost perfectly on time with our hurricane drill that we are currently doing in the utility. We started yesterday morning at 8 o'clock with a notice of all management. We had 200 of the managers report for duty at our auditorium in the building next door. We decided to move to the next level given the scenario that we were playing out. This morning we met essentially at 3 o'clock this morning. We were really there at 8, but the scenario had us there at 3 to 5 to put forward our first emergency planning. We had 100 people. We were completely operating and had the facility set up in our emergency control center and operations. We're meeting again tomorrow morning because we'll be riding out the storm tonight, and we'll be engaged tomorrow with assessment. We're expected to right at 3 o'clock. The hurricane is rolling in with hurricane force winds. We expect about 9 to 12 hours of that through the evening. And so tomorrow morning at first sunlight, we'll be in the assessment process. We send out engineers. We've got a whole protocol of doing that. We report back the assessment and then start the restoration, which will run through Thursday. We meet again Thursday morning, update that plan, make sure. The key here is to make sure that the communication among all of the moving parts of the utility are in line and lined up and ready to take on some of the challenges that we might have. And then on Friday morning, we debrief and demobilize. And at that point in time, we gather all of the information and make sure that we have documented every step of everyone's journey throughout the entire process so we can put in a nice claim to the federal government and assure that we'll get paid or reimbursed for expenditures taken on behalf of our restoration process. So it's a big effort. We really plan all year long, but this is an opportunity to exercise our plan and make sure again that the key communications between all the moving parts are effective and that everybody's aware of who's going to speak to whom and at what time, that we have the proper resources aligned, that we've called out. And actually, part of the simulation, we have reached out now and called for some mutual aid support from other utilities, certainly to the north of us, that won't get hit by this storm. So they're on standby, and a number of other standby activities occurring. So if you hear whispers of a hurricane, don't worry. It's just a simulation, but the entire management team is engaged in that this week, and we're just preparing for the worst. We do have and are engaged. I meet at least on a monthly basis with the city's EOC. So I'm involved with them and on the mayor's senior council, should there an event be that wouldn't call for citywide or countywide involvement. That's my report.
Very good. Thanks. Any questions of our CEO? Well, we're just about ready for adjournment. I do have a couple comments I want to share with you. I thought this was a very good meeting. Enjoyed the ethics training. I thought that was appropriate and meaningful. Help us all on that subject. Summer months, you know, we're required to meet every month by charter. The board of directors has to meet monthly. So I'd like for you to think about your summer schedule. You have to have four members for a quorum in attendance at the meeting, and then the others, if the other three are available, to call in for the meeting. But without four people in attendance, we've got a problem. So we want to try to get on top of that and see if there's if we have to change dates to get four people from time to time. We're not going to not have a meeting. We're going to have to work for a meeting. It might not be a problem. And I know about where I'm going to be most of the summer. I assume you all know about where you're going to be. And we know presently it's the third Tuesday of each month. So think about that. Contact Paul and his staff, and let's get ahead of that so we're not running around in the last minute trying to figure out how to get a quorum. I would like to congratulate our team. I know it's a team effort for the media activity, the presence of the JEA in the media. We've had a lot of good press, and that we all know that doesn't just happen. I mean, you deserve it, number one, and number two, you have to be proactive to compete with the other opportunities for media and press. And I've been really pleased. A couple of key issues too. I think the water issue and other key issues that we're dealing with. So my hat's off to Paul and the staff for that. I think it's a good sign and a sign of, I'm sure, more good things to come.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to say also I was very pleased that we got notification when things were coming up. Excuse me, in the press. That was very helpful, don't you think?
Yeah.
So that we looked out for it, and then when someone asked us about it, we had a heads up that it was occurring. So I'd like to again commend Paul and his staff.
Right. Thank you.
Keep that up. That was very good. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
As we all know, we're deeply involved in the referendum activities, and I think the referendum activities are receiving similar, maybe not as good as the JEA, but certainly similar positive reaction to what they're trying to do there. And even the editorials have been, looked like Hightower wrote them. So having said all that, one more thing I want to say for Monica and Brian and Mike and Paul. I live in Atlantic Beach, and I have witnessed the last 2 weeks the biggest movement of JEA equipment I've seen outside of a hurricane in about a 1 or 2 or 3 mile strip there along, I don't know what they're doing, along Seminole. These big, beautiful trucks and all these people working and crowd, the car control seems to me like the biggest challenge. And I have to tell you, they did a master job. It was really, they've been down there. It looks like they might have cleaned up and leaving now, but along Seminole Drive, which is a pretty busy road there.
Yes, yes.
Now, Mike, I don't know if we have an app for that, but the people in those cars, people in those cars are customers too, and you know they had people there managing those cars coming through there, and I was so proud. I wave at them. I never stopped and told them who it was, but I was proud of them every time I went through there. So I passed that along to. I'd be interested to know what they were doing, I guess, but they were working.
Absolutely.
And they were getting the job done. So yeah. I was proud of them.
You know, Mr. Chairman, when I was chairman of the Jacksonville Transportation Authority, there were a couple times those bus drivers almost took me out. I sort of waved at them too. Right?
I was careful. I felt like I knew those guys up there messing with those hot wires. I feel like I met them here last month. Anything else to come before the board? What do you want to do? Oh, yeah, we have time for this. I would like to read this. This is from our friend, Governor Rick Scott. This is very nice, dated February 22nd, 2016. Dear friends, congratulations on being recognized for, quote, highest customer satisfaction with business electric service in the South among mid-sized utilities, close quote, by J.D. Power. As governor, I commend your commitment to the Jacksonville community and to our state. This recognition represents the tremendous talent that can be found throughout our state as Floridians work to achieve their dream. Florida businesses have created more than 1 million jobs in just 5 years because of our efforts to diversify our economy and cut taxes. Our goal is to make Florida first in job creation so families can find jobs and great opportunities. We have made great progress in growing jobs and investing in education, and we'll keep working to make Florida first. Again, congratulations. And know that I remain committing to making our state the best place for Floridians to follow their dreams.
Very good.
Very nice.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
Good stuff. That's good.
Nothing else to come before the board. We'll stand adjourned. Thank you.